Good morning. Welcome to worship and happy 4th of July. Thank you, Jane. I have quite a few announcements today, actually. First off, we had VBS last week, and it was lovely. We had a two-day vacation Bible school, and we had counselors come up from UMM again, and the kids had a blast. And I'm trying to decide if I have the guts to share with you the song that I have learned on repeat. It was pretty intense. Do any of you know Bananas for the Lord? Okay. I want to share this with you because it's that exquisite. He's a peach of a savior. He's the apple of my eye. He trims away the branches when the branches get too high. He bears fruit in season when the... And his love will never die. That's why I'm bananas for the Lord. Glory, glory, we're the branches. Glory, glory, we're the branches. Glory, glory, we're the branches. That's why we're bananas for the Lord. Jump! So, if you want to hear that song about 100 times in a four-day span, just spend a little time with Sophie Sue, and she will get you hooked. It is great fun. I also have a note here from the counselors. They say, Crosby Concordia Church, thank you so much for having us. We had a fantastic time and couldn't have reached these kiddos without you. Thank you for inviting us into your community. May the Lord be with you. Thank you so much, Raquel Archer. Thanks, Peyton Pemberton. Thank you for having us. I had a great time hanging out with all the kiddos. Alex Ortiz, Heather Verberg. Thank you, Vanessa Blanchett. Oh, also, John 15:5. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That is UMM's Upper Missouri Ministries theme this year. I don't know the answer to that. I think there was like 40. There were about nine to 10 pre-K or potty trained through kindergartners in the morning part of the day. And then there were more of the bigger kids. Zach and I took turns each day reading stories to the younger crew, so I was more familiar with them. But they had good fun. And one of the things that I was really impressed by was the older kids took turns at our sending worship service. We had a community meal and worship service on Tuesday evening. And the older kids took time sharing where they saw God during that time. And it was really neat to see the kids. They, one at a time, all on their own, would stand up there and say something. They were very brave. I was very proud. So, thank you for participating in that that ministry. It is an important thing we do each year, Vacation Bible School. A couple of other announcements. Sons of Norway, Vita Lodge, and Meadowlark Council, along with Scandinavian Musical Group, are presenting the Looney Lutherans Saturday, July 10th at 7 p.m. at the Kirchhofer Auditorium at DCHS. Free will offering, all ages welcome. So it's this Saturday at 10. Also, if you know any 8th through 12th graders interested in the high school summer Medora music, not music, summer Medora trip, we are taking a crew down there. Pastor Zach is taking a crew down there. It's really hard to say Medora without following it with music. Has anybody ever noticed that? Okay, and then finally, two more things. One, we had Kurt Knutsvig's funeral here at Memorial Service here yesterday, and there's a pasta salad and a potato salad in the fridge downstairs, which will be much happier today. There's two potato salads. There are two potato salads downstairs. please someone take them. They will be much happier if someone takes them now than discovers them eons from now. All right. And then finally, I wanted to say some words about last Sunday. Who was here last Sunday? Yes. Does anybody have some, did you guys bring a number or your little notebook to say how many Holy Spirit waves you had? Did anybody remember? One, two, yes. Three? I can't see that far away. A couple? Three? Wonderful. Please, please, please remember to write that on, so I put a little date thing out there. So just write like three, or what, I mean, write your number. And then we'll tally them up. There's also doves out there. If you want to turn around and look at the windows, you can see some doves. And if you want to write your number on there and or write what you witnessed and hang it up, then we can see and be encouraged by this visual reminder. So please do that. And now that I said all that, I'm going to say something in an opposite order than I should have. Last week, for those of you who weren't here, we talked about Holy Spirit moments and moments that we notice God showing up and God active and doing things in our lives or in the lives of others. And I invited people to pay attention to that and notice and remember and write it down. So I passed out these itty-bitty little notebooks. So if you were not here, I would love to give you one. This is a 5-week project that we're going to pay attention to how we're seeing God at work in the world. And I won't make you stand up and tell a story unless you want to. But it can be something just writing down as simple as, like, when I was gardening, and how you and when you saw God at work in your life. So does anybody want a notebook? You're welcome. Okay. You're welcome. And please remember to write down your number out on the sign out there. Our theme for the next, for 5 weeks, so this week and three more, is Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. So that's the slew of announcements I have. Does anyone else have any additional announcements? No. All right. I invite you into a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Good and gracious God, we give thanks for your presence among us. We thank you that you are alive and active in our lives, that you move us and stir us to love you and to love one another. We pray that you open our hearts and minds to hear what you would say to us this day. Stir us into action and move us to good works. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to rise. We gather in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by Christ's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to be seated for our gathering song, Come Thou Font of Every Blessing. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, you bless us with your presence in our daily lives. You invite us to come and see, taste, and know your goodness. We pray that you open our eyes to your presence in our lives. Help us to notice what you are up to in our lives and in the lives of others. Help us to point out your presence to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our reading this morning comes from the book of 1 Samuel chapter 3. 1 Samuel chapter 3. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, and he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there calling as before, "Samuel!" And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house, from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli, but Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then Eli said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." Word of God, word of life. At the time of Eli and Samuel, we are told, the word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. Okay, so a little background on this boy, Samuel. There was a woman named Hannah whose husband had two wives. The one wife bore lots of children, but Hannah was barren, and the other wife gave her grief about it all the time and made Hannah's life miserable. So one time, Hannah was praying silently before God, and Eli the priest was sitting there, and he saw her lips moving and no words coming out. And he assumed that she was drunk, and he called her out on it. Hannah insisted she was not drunk, but was praying earnestly and shared her story with Eli, who said to her, "Go in peace, and may God grant what you ask." And Hannah did indeed conceive. She gave birth to a boy, Samuel. And in gratitude, she dedicated him to service in the temple. So when Samuel was weaned, Hannah brought Samuel to Eli, and every year, I think this part is cute, every year Hannah would bring Samuel a little temple outfit. She'd make him a new one every year so that he could have one that fit him. And this boy Samuel grew to be the one who would identify David as the king. He has an important role. But as a boy, he ministered with Eli. And Eli had grown a little lazy. He had two sons who served in the temple, but they did horrible things. They bullied those making sacrifices to get the meat that they wanted. They took offerings from people before the people could do the ritual pieces of the offering. They slept around with women who served at the entrance where people came to spend time with God. So by the time we see Eli with Samuel, Eli seems tired. He is discouraged. He's done. He knows that his sons have been doing horrid things, and he hasn't done anything about it. So with that background, we hear, the word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. People, even Samuel, who worked in the temple, the place of worship, who was helping or serving in the church, as it were, had not been taught to listen for God's voice. People did not know God's voice when they heard it. They couldn't recognize God's voice. Do you think that this is true for us today? Do you think others struggle to discern God's voice? I do not want that to be us. So today we are focusing on aiming to be ready and listening for God's voice in the lives of others. How beautiful would that be? God was calling out to Samuel, and Samuel didn't recognize God's voice. So he went running to Eli, assuming that it was Eli calling him, and three times he did this. Finally, Eli realized what was happening and instructed Sam to listen to the Lord God. Sometimes we are Eli in this scenario, and sometimes we are Samuel. There is the experienced one who may or may not be lying down, the one whose eyes have seen a lot, eyes that may be growing dim. That can mean a tiredness. It can even mean not hearing voices, God's voice, as crisply as in other times in our lives. Whatever the state of the experienced one, an important role is highlighted in this story. We are called to help others identify God's voice in their lives. The experienced one is called to stay on our toes, keep our eyes open, ready to hear someone else receive a word from God and help them notice the gift that is happening in their lives. Now, Eli was done, discouraged, jaded. Now, I'm not saying that that's where all people who are experienced are at. Some perhaps, but not all. But what I want to highlight is that Samuel was dedicated for service in the temple. This was his lifelong vocation since he was very first weaned. But he needed Eli. He needed Eli's help in this scenario. And Eli missed it at first. Three times Samuel came to him. "You called me. What is it? How can I help you?" "No, I didn't call you." Three times this happens, which means it wasn't a fluke thing like Peter denying Jesus. Three times it happened, that meant it happened for real. It was no distracted accident. It was the truth pouring out in action. Eli was not ready and expectant for Samuel to hear God's voice. Something needed to change. Something wasn't quite right. Eli was missing something. But then he caught up. Finally, the third time, Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli said to Samuel, "Go and lie down. If the Lord calls you again, say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." Here's the thing. Even if you are not the one hearing, maybe you're lying down, or maybe you just weren't there. God speaks to all of us, and we are not all there at the same time. Even if you are not the one hearing firsthand, you can still be the one to name God's voice. You can listen to others as they talk and point out where you see God speaking in their life. Sisters and brothers, it is important that we also listen to the voice of God in the lives of others. It is really important, so let me say it again. Let us listen for the voice of God in the lives of others. Let us listen for the voice of God in the lives of others. I think this is big. This is key. I wanted to start with this part, our Eli role, before turning to Samuel, because I think sometimes it is easier to see something in someone else's life. It can be easier to observe and identify something in someone else's life than noticing it within your own life. There's so much going on in life, but when it's filtered through someone else's eyes or through the stories you hear from someone else, it can be easier to hear those notes carry through, hear and discern from another perspective. This is one of the reasons why talk therapy can be so helpful, or journaling your thoughts. Let's listen to one another and listen for what God is doing, where God is showing up in each other's lives. Let's listen to one another so that we can say, "Wow, when I hear you talk about going into that field or career, you really brighten up. I think God might be calling you to that. You seem so much more at peace now that you're back. It seems like God was really working within you as you were away." That's like the fifth time you've mentioned going there. Sounds like God might have stuck it in your mind to go. Does that sound right to you? How lovely would it be to serve one another in this way? Imagine one of us saying to you, "I can see God in your life, and here is how." Wouldn't that be encouraging? To experience that validation from other believers, to have a reminder, attention drawn to that bright spot. You know what? Yeah. You're right. I would have missed that if you hadn't mentioned it. Or even, "Yeah, I saw that too. Isn't God great?" Dear ones, I invite you to keeping an eye out, keeping your ears perked up to notice God at work. In your life, as we were called to last week, let's keep doing that, but also in the lives of others. Who is someone you can listen to and help identify God's voice in their life? As you pay attention for Holy Spirit waves this week, I invite you to not only look for them in your own life, but also in the lives of others around you. As you listen to a loved one speak, do you hear God's presence in their life? A moment of calm, aid in a struggle, comfort or excitement in life? Notice these two. Write them down in your book and add them to the tally. I saw God in these ways in these people's life and also in my own life in these ways. What a fun tally. And I invite you to even dare to tell the person in whom you have witnessed it. I see God working in your life. Together, we'll make a radical change in how often God is noticed in our lives. How exciting. So keep working on those little notebooks, and let's see what we can witness God doing. God is active. Thanks be to God. So a reminder, if you're looking for God at work, look for evidence, for the fruit of the Spirit. love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. God at work. Or look for the things God has promised to do. In Jesus, we hear Christ's mission. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. When we witness these things, we witness God working, the Holy Spirit moving, stirring. This is what God is up to. Let's see. Let's notice. Let's remember together. And now let's sing about the Holy Spirit doing so many things as we sing Spirit of Gentleness.
Wind on the
I invite you to rise. Together, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Together, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Good and gracious God, we give thanks for the church. Thank you for gifting us with this call and mission and focus in our lives. Thank you for the church throughout the world in all places and times. We pray for those who struggle with doubt, who struggle to experience your forgiveness in Jesus Christ. We pray for those who are persecuted because of their faith. Help us to proclaim your love in word and deed. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for your good creation. We pray for water to nourish the earth. We pray for healthy climate and temperatures. We pray for healing of water, land, and sky. Help us to be good stewards of all that you bless us with. Lord, in your mercy. God of justice and peace, you are capable of healing divisions in the depths of our being. You are capable of healing divisions that have festered for years, even centuries. We pray for your reconciliation. We pray for your healing. Help us to be made new and to live in this truth. We pray for peace within our homes and families and communities. We pray for peace within our nation and around the world. We also pray for justice, for care for all. Help us to be agents of both your peace and your justice. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those in need of your healing touch. Especially we lift up to you Larry, Doreen, Geraldine, Bruce, Jordan, Butch, Larrett, Andrew, Gary, Jamie, Daryl, Judy, Wanda, Bob, Regna, Lane, John, Dale, Colin, Les, Kiana, Andrea, Bev, Kurt, Marcia, Vernie, Cora, Braden, Brian, JJ, Merlin, Jan, Kirby, Andrea, Sophie and the Barnabas Team Mission, and also friends and family of Curtis Knudsvig, and friends and family of Angela Jacobson, and others whom we name silently and aloud. Lord, in your mercy. God, we pray for mothers who desperately long to have children. We pray for those who are pregnant and those who have suffered the death of a child. We pray for eyes and ears to hear your voice in our lives and to see and hear your voice in the lives of others and have the wisdom and strength to name it. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for the faithful departed who have gone before us. Help us to be good witnesses as so many have before us. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you see we need, we entrust to your grace, to your care, trusting in your grace and mercy in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. I invite you to share a wave of peace to one another. I invite, one moment. Do you want to do a special song during offering? Yep. I invite you to be seated for some special music. Let us pray. God of mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to the help of all in need, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord. Amen. At this time, if you do not already have one of these little communion cups, I invite you to go and grab one in the narthex. I will give you instruction as to the right, as to when to open it and eat it. You're welcome to open it beforehand to get ready, but I will let you know when it is time to eat and drink. First, let us hear the story of Christ's life and death and resurrection. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new promise in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim, we share the story of Christ's life and death and resurrection until he comes again. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. This is the Lord's table, and all are welcome. At this time, I invite you to open that first clear layer for the wafer. This is the body of Christ given for you. And open the juice as well. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. I invite you to receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and fill you with peace. Amen. And all God's children shouted, Amen. Amen. We join in song, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Oh,
and serve the Lord.